Merry Christmas, friends, and welcome to this service at First Presbyterian Church in Ferguson, Missouri. Today, we have basically a skeleton crew here today. We've decided, because of the surge of COVID, that we would protect one another by taking this Sunday off from having people in church and next Sunday, to give 2 weeks between the celebrations people have at Christmas and New Year's Eve. So we're glad you're with us this day. Today's service is going to be slightly different. We're following a pattern that we started last year when we did the Hispanic celebration of the Christmas season. Today we're looking at Christmas through the lens of the Orthodox, the Eastern Orthodox Church, which comprises Greek Orthodox, Russian Orthodox, Coptic churches, Ethiopian Orthodox. There's a whole host of traditions that practice what they call the way of faith orthodoxy. And one of the things that Orthodox people do is to celebrate not one day of Christmas, but 12 days of Christmas. That is the time between December 25th and Epiphany, the day after Epiphany. January 7th is actually the Orthodox celebration of Christmas. And so we're celebrating the 12 days of Christmas here at First Church. And one of the things that our Orthodox brothers and sisters do, when the priest says, Christ is born, the response is, glorify him. So, Christ is born.
Glorify him.
Amen. So our first hymn today is 153, and Bethlehem, a newborn boy.
Heard the 12 days of Christmas refer to the period between Christmas and the eve of Epiphany. This is a time of celebration, rejoicing in the birth of our Lord and Savior. And as the angels proclaim to the shepherds, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news and tidings of great joy, which will be to all people. For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord." So how do we celebrate the 12 days of Christmas in our homes? We should take time to give thanks for all of the blessings in life. Have you ever made a Thanksgiving tree instead of a Christmas tree? Consider making Thanksgiving ornaments using leftover wrapping paper, ribbon, and markers. Now, you may ask your parents if you can go through the trash to get the used paper, because they might not think that's a great idea. But if you'll take some paper, write things that you're thankful for on the paper, cut them out in different shapes, and use the ribbon to hang them on your tree, then the tree will eventually be taken away. But we should strive to continue every single day to remember the joyous gift that we received on Christmas. And Mike and Jody were hanging the ornaments that those of us that are doing worship service today, what we were thankful for. So I'm going to take mine home after church today and put mine on my tree to remind me of all the things that we're thankful for this year. The scripture this morning is from Luke, chapter 2, verses 22 through 35. The time has come for Joseph and Mary to perform the ceremony of purification, as the law of Moses commanded. So they took the child to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every firstborn male is to be dedicated to the Lord. They also went to offer a sacrifice of a pair of doves or two young pigeons, as required by the law of the Lord. At that time, there was a man named Simeon living in Jerusalem. He was a good, God-fearing person and was waiting for Israel to be saved, and had assured him, the Holy Spirit was with him and had assured him that he would not die before he had seen the Lord's promised Messiah. Led by the Spirit, Simeon went into the temple. When the parents brought the child Jesus into the temple to do for him what the law required, Simeon took the child in his arms and gave thanks to God. "Now, Lord, you have kept your promise, and you may let your servant go in peace. With my own eyes I have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light to reveal your will to the Gentiles and bring glory to your people, Israel." The child's father and mother were amazed at these things. Simeon said about him. Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother, "This child is chosen by God for the destruction and the salvation of many in Israel. He will be a sign from God which many people will speak against, and so reveal their secret thoughts. And sorrow like a sharp sword will break your own heart." Our scripture continues. Joel of the tribe of Asher. She had been married for only 7 years and was now 84 years old. She never left the temple. Day and night she worshiped God, fasting and praying. That same hour,
so we're going to do something a little different today. We're just going to have a little round tree discussion about three of the more important feast days within the 12 days of Christmas. So I'm going to be joined by Lee and by Jody, and we're going to have just a little discussion so that you may know a little bit more about what our Orthodox brothers and sisters not only believe, but what they do.
Good morning. I would like briefly to talk about the life of Stephen the Protomartyr. He was an early Christian convert, one of the original seven deacons ordained by the apostles, and the first martyr of the Orthodox Church. The Church remembers the martyrdom of Saint Stephen today on December 27th. Saint Stephen was a Jew living in the Hellenic provinces, related to the Apostle Paul, and one of the first seven deacons ordained by the apostles to serve the church in Jerusalem, thus making him an archdeacon. Saint Stephen is known as the first martyr, the first to shed his blood for the gospel. Stephen was one of seven appointed to minister to the needs of the poor of Jerusalem. He was chosen because he was a man full of faith and the Holy Spirit. Stephen's faith gave him the power to do great wonders and signs among the people. In addition to his work among the poor, the Holy Spirit worked powerfully through Stephen's faith, even though some of the Jews disputed his work. Just as with Jesus who preceded him, some of the Jewish governing body, the Sanhedrin, felt fearful and threatened by Stephen's methods and message. Lies were told about him, including that his teachings were blasphemous. But Stephen reminded the people of the miracles God had worked through him and even chastised those responsible for the crucifixion of Jesus. At this point, the people who were most enraged cast Stephen out of Jerusalem and stoned him. Even as this happened, he looked upward and shouted, "Look, I see the heavens open, and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God." Even as he was being stoned to death, Stephen was calling out to God. Far off on a hill stood the Virgin Mary and Saint John the theologian, who prayed for Saint Stephen while he was being stoned and witnessed this first martyrdom for the Son of God. Soon after this, the young Jewish leader named Saul turned his life over to Christ and became known as the Apostle Paul, Saint Paul.
I know I was reading some of the Saint Stephen stuff too, and it was, I can't remember the phrasing exactly, but it was much like when Jesus was on the cross and he said, "God, forgive them, they know what don't know what they do." He also begged that they, God doesn't punish them for this act that they were doing during the stoning.
Yes.
So I thought that was, that parallel was interesting.
Right.
Yeah. So going on through the week of the 12 days, we're at January 1st. It's a feast day, and it's for Saint Basil the Great. He was born in 329-330 AD in Caesarea, Cappadocia. He came from a rich and very pious family. Many of his immediate relatives are also saints of our church. As a young man, he received the best education of his time in areas such as philosophy, history, rhetoric, astronomy, medicine, and geometry, not only in his native Caesarea, but also in Constantinople and Athens. In Athens, he called cultivated a strong friendship with the young St. Gregory, later called the theologian, a relationship that lasted for their whole lives. Upon completion of his studies, he returned to Caesarea, and where he was initially pursued a career as a rhetoric. Soon under the influence of his older sister, Macrina, he decided to give up his career and live as a monastic in voluntary poverty. He led an ascetic life together with his friend, St. Gregory the theologian, building monasteries and establishing guidelines for cenobitic monasticism. In 370, he became the bishop of Caesarea, where he ministered to his flock with great love and selflessness. He established hospitals, schools, orphanages, and homes for the elderly. These institutions together consisted a small community named Basilidia. And St. Basil fought fervently against heresies, false teachings, and wrote extensively on how to live and worship in the Orthodox way. He is considered the author of the Divine Liturgy bearing his name, which is celebrated 10 times during the year. A laboring ascetic, St. Basil responded in complete poverty and in poor health on January 1st, 379, at the age of 49, he passed away. And that's why January 1st is chosen as his feast day, versus the fact that it's also our celebration of the new year. So there's the Vasilopita tradition. The Greek tradition of the Vasilopita is an important part of the Greek New Year's Day celebration. A special cake containing a hidden coin is cut and shared among the members of the household. Whoever gets the piece with the coin hidden inside is considered to have St. Basil's blessing for the whole year. This tradition is said to be based on the story that follows. During a time of famine, when the emperor demanded an excessive tax from the people of Caesarea, each family had to give up all their valuables, money, and our jewelry. Upon finding out this injustice, St. Basil fearlessly defended his people, calling the emperor to repentance. The emperor was moved by St. Basil's speech, canceled the tax, and returned all the valuables to the saint. The saint was faced with a daunting task. Out of a large amount of items, he had to return each one to its rightful owner. He prayed and then prepared a huge cake and baked the treasure inside it. After calling his flock to prayer, he blessed and cut the cake, offering a piece to each person. Miraculously, each owner received his own valuables in the piece of the cake. Vasilopitas have been baked on St. Basil's feast day every year since his repose to commemorate this miracle. So my household has baked a Vasilopita bread, and I wish to cut it up and share it around the people who are here giving you this service today. And there is a coin in there, so we'll see who has the luck for next year, 2021. I think we'll all have luck in 2021. But we'll see if someone has extra special while Mike continues this chat.
Okay.
So the last feast day that I will talk about is January 4th, and it's called the Synapsis of the 70 Apostles. We know the story of the 12 apostles that Jesus anointed, but in Luke tells the unique story of Jesus sending out 70. 70 apostles sharing good news, two by two they would go. So 35 groups were sent out into the community to make a difference, to be good news and preach good news. And the Orthodox Church remembers this sending out, and it's a reminder for each one of us as we too have been sent out by God. And so our celebration, I hope you'll find this kind of little history, a little experience of how our brothers and sisters in the Eastern Church share good news, how they celebrate God's love. It may be a little different than we Western Christians do, but it's a reminder that each of us are called to celebrate God's love and to take where we live, our own traditions, and to share them with our brothers and sisters.
So anybody find a coin? Oh, who has it?
I have it.
Yay!
May the blessings of St. Basil go with you.
There you go.
Until 2021.
Thank you.
Is that like the force?
It could be. It could be. The Orthodox force. So you've heard a little bit about our Orthodox friends. And so as we come into this end of our service, it is our time to gather prayers. Paula, do we have any requests?
Not at this time. No.
No. Some of you may have heard through email, and those of you who are joining with us today, we ask you to keep in prayer our sister in Christ, Judy Taylor. Judy passed away this past week, and to remember her husband Stephen and their daughter Barbara. We also have our Thanksgiving tree of prayers, and there are, I just like to use a few of these in our prayer time. To be thankful for family. Thankful for our church friends and church family, even during these times of challenges. Thanksgiving for doctors, nurses, and vaccines. Thanks for the joy, humor, compassion, and love that people share with one another during good times and bad times. So those are our prayers from our Thanksgiving tree. May they resonate in our heart and lead us in our work together in 2021. Let us pray. Everlasting One, whose love knows no geographic bounds, whose love reaches through the lengths of culture, men and women who have heard your voice and responded in their own unique way, given their own situation and place. And so, although our brothers and sisters are waiting to January 7th for their Christmas, we share in their 12 days of Christmas. We give you thanks for Stephen, who did not let fear get in his way, but followed his heart and saw the world us as Jesus sends us into the world to bless, to lift up, to be a sign of God's love and goodness. So we pray as we move toward a new year that these Thanksgivings may resonate in our hearts and minds. And despite the difficult challenges that we still will face, that our hearts will be filled with thanksgivings, and that we would be thankful for the many gifts that we have received. We pray that it would be with the Taylor family over the loss of Judy. She no longer suffers. Her battle's over. And now she lies in the hands and life of a loving God who will not let her go. We lift up Stephen and Barbara as they begin to adjust to the loss of Judy in their lives. We pray that their grief may be a grief that gives them courage to remember Judy in her loving way, the way she smiled and cared about other people, the way she liked to talk and be around folks, and that the life that she lived was indeed a blessing despite the challenges of her MS. And the difficulties she had from life because of this disease. May we be full of joy like Judy was, and that your Thanksgiving may go with us. So wrap your arms around your church that is scattered throughout the world, Eastern, Western, North, and South. Orthodox folks, people who are looking, people who are seeking, people who have not yet been able to commit themselves to you. May all of us be joined together as the great family of God as we pray these words that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the glory, forever. Amen. So our last hymn for today is God of All the Circling Years. December 27th, the day of Stephen, the first martyr in the Eastern Church. We hope that what you learned today or experienced may be helpful for you, and that you might even bake your own cake with your own coin and start that as a tradition of your family to celebrate the good works of Basil, the monk, the one who showed a different way of living in the ancient world. As we go from this place, we remember that our Greek Orthodox brothers and sisters, when they say to one another, Christ is born,
glorify God.
And may we glorify God with God's love and grace in all that we do.